I have like 10 slides max. And the reason I have some slides is so that we can talk about why I'm demonstrating what I'm going to do. This is a talk called The Quest for the Next Evolution of Infrastructure Management. Hands up who manages their infrastructure via code. A few people. Excellent. Excellent. The rest of you, I'm really hoping by the end of this session you actually want to start managing your infrastructure. I have to say, I'm delighted with the last talk. The keynote by Timothy was fantastic because everything that Timothy said about continuous delivery for product, I can actually reiterate for continuous delivery for infrastructure. So it was like perfect timing. We're actually going to talk about here how we can make our infrastructure better and more dependable. Remember that phrase that Timothy said? Staging environments are bad. The reason they're bad is because environments in general. About me, I'm an infrastructure engineer. I'm a reformed ASP.NET C# developer. I do not like product development anymore. I fell out of love with it because I find it boring because of those stupid code reviews where you get people telling you that your libraries are poor choices and stuff like that. So again, that's very good. I'm a DevOps extremist and I love everything to do with DevOps. I go to many, many conferences and speak about these types of practices, continuous delivery, continuous integration, DevOps, infrastructure management. So, where we got to, okay, is in the beginning, we have what are now known as Snowflake servers. We have these long running infrastructure servers, usually Windows. Okay, I have to admit, it's usually a Windows problem, where the server was created once in 1999, and we continually patch that server. We continually make manual changes to that server, and we probably can never decommission the application from that server. Not saying that that's a bad thing. It happens and it's very, very common. But unfortunately, it makes our lives a little bit more difficult. It really does. Has anyone in this room still got Windows 2003 production? We do, right? Some of us actually do. Because we have these long-running servers that have never been able to go. By the way, Snowflake servers is a coined term by Martin Fowler in 2012. Okay, the idea is that each server is individually unique because so many manual changes have been made to that server, you cannot guarantee it's exactly the same as the other. Okay, so Snowflake is a fantastic way of putting it. Okay. Usually, Snowflake servers follow a runbook. I have been a member of a company that had a Word document as a runbook. It was 56 pages of a Word document. The screenshots were for 2003. The servers were 2008. And then after that 56-page document, there was another 26 pages for security. This was painful. And I mean painful. Because when we were configuring our servers, we would know and say, oh, well, we can skip step 17 and we can come back and do that later. Seriously. And instead of going and updating the runbook, we would go, it's fine, we know that. But the next person to come in and configure a server doesn't know that. And they don't know that step 17 actually has a dependency on step 42. Anyone's mom ever had a nice set of china plates? Okay. Now, they're our pride and joy, okay? And we would always get the china plates out when someone important came around for dinner. And if we chip the china plate or drop the china plate, what would happen is that we would try and we would actually super glue it back together. Okay? This is exactly what we do in our long-running infrastructure. We manually handcraft it and we really try and glue everything together and get it working every time we need to. This is extremely difficult. This is very difficult. So that was in the beginning. Okay, this is what we did do. And now we move to an era of configuration management. Hands up who uses a configuration management tool? So Chef, Puppet, Ansible, Salt, CF Engine, Windows SCCM. There's loads of them, okay? Loads and loads of configuration management tools out there. Big step forward for our industry. Huge step forward for the industry. And if you are doing it, nice work. Really good work. And keep driving that forward, okay? So for those who don't use configuration management tools, they're a tool that allow you to describe the state that a server needs to be at, and then the configuration management tool will keep it at that level. Okay. So for those nasty sysadmins who have very prying hands and tinkering fingers, who SSH and RDP in the boxes and change things around, the configuration management tool will report that and it will change it back. Big win. Big win. This would allow us to develop what's called Phoenix. Okay. Because we know the state of which the machine, the state of which the machine should be at, and it's automated, we can destroy a machine and bring it back up and know that that machine will be at exactly the same point. Okay. This is another term that was coined in 2012. Martin Fowler worked for ThoughtWorks, he was the chief scientist of ThoughtWorks. This one was actually by someone called Cornelius Sietzmann, again within ThoughtWorks. But it was made public in Martin Fowler's blog post about Phoenix servers in 2012. And it helps us move away from the idea that when we test applications in development, it works fine. But when we push it to production or staging, it's broken. Timothy talked about it in the last keynote. He talked about the fact that our environments are so poor that we usually have to build broken dependencies or busted packages. Well, and when we push code there, it can never really guarantee that it's going to work. But what do? We shrug our shoulders and go, we know production's fine. We'll just push it to production anyway. This is a really vicious cycle. So parts of the industry have moved on. This is not a Docker talk. If you're expecting me to include Docker today, I will not be. I'm not against Docker. I think Docker is very good. I do not use it for what I'm going to demo. So we've moved on to an era of what's called inline infrastructure. And this was actually a thought process written in 2013 by Chad Fowler. Chad Fowler worked for Six Fundekindle, who were acquired recently by Microsoft, and they actually built Wunderlist. So absolutely fantastic product that we lots of issues day to day. And what he said is that we should be able to trash our servers and burn our code on immutable infrastructure and disposable components. Jez Humble and Martin Fowler have said, it's funny in some of the blog posts you've read about it, that they would love to be able to test companies' way of being able to automate their process and come back online if they could walk into someone's data center with a chainsaw, a baseball bat, and just start beating everything and cutting everything. Because if you're not in a situation where things are automated and you come back up and you have a very big disaster, you're going to be in some trouble. EC2 nodes are a good way to think about immutable infrastructure. Okay, we spin them up, supposedly, for a very short amount of time to do a job, and then when we're finished, we shut them down again. Think of like testing an application, just think of messing around with AWS. The cloud in general, it only... This talk basically came from the fact that in September 2015, I wrote a post on this, a blog post, and how the realization came to me that I was treating my cloud infrastructure in the same way that I used to treat my physical data center infrastructure. And I used to really hold on to it, and things were given like friendly names, and I used to refer to servers by names and stuff like that. And then I realized it doesn't matter, because those servers are brought up for a purpose for a very short amount of time for a lifespan, and then I destroy them. So the thought process of immutable infrastructure was a much better way of thinking about it. Fortunately, any functional programmers in here? I believe some functional programmers were like, well, it's not immutable infrastructure, because immutability is not that way, which a lot of people were like, actually, they've got a real good point. So last year, they decided that it was going to be called disposable infrastructure, because now it makes much more sense. A great way to think about disposable infrastructure, if your long-running servers are nice china plates, disposable infrastructure is a big stack of paper plates. We know that they're built in the same way, we know that they're roughly exactly the same, and that we know that we can use them once, throw them away. And because they're so flimsy, we don't want to use them more than once because the food might fall through. So, demo time. That is pretty much all the slides. Okay, that's less than 10 minutes. I am going to use the HashiCorp tools. Okay. I am not an employee of HashiCorp. I'm not here to sell you on their products in any way, shape, or form. There are lots of products out there that do exactly the same job. Cloud Formation is one. Sparkle Formation is another. I am going to be using a tool today called Terraform. So we're going to use this tool called Terraform. Terraform is a tool that will allow us to specify our infrastructure. Any questions so far? Let's see if this comes back. This is like all demos. If this happens again, you're just going to have to pretend that you can see the screen. And because there's a camera there, clap if they didn't. Just ever so often, just go, that's good. Right. Use infrastructure as code tools. Firstly, everything it was said in the main keynote this morning, everything should be an artifact that we keep in source. Our infrastructure is as important an artifact as our build, our packages, and our actual product code. Okay. If you cannot see the change log against the production infrastructure, how can you understand when a breaking change has been made into an environment? Because what we usually do as system administrators in the cloud is we usually log on to the AWS console and we usually manually edit things. Okay. And then what happens is that one person builds up a knowledge base of how you do something. And that person is probably offered a lot of money by Apple or Google or one of the big companies, and they leave. And then that just leaves your company stuck as if they go, what do I do now? That person is gone, and therefore, I have no idea what to do. So, with Terraform, we declare a provider. Okay. There are providers for many things, I'll show you later. The providers I will use today to demonstrate things are AWS, DigitalOcean, and if I get some time, just because I'm feeling a bit adventurous, Azure. But we've only got an hour and a half, so we may not even be able to log into Azure. Apologies if anyone works for Microsoft. This is just a long-running joke between me and Microsoft. So you give it a region, you tell Terraform what region you want to build your infrastructure in, and you give it an access key and a secret key. That's your IAM code. Okay? You go to AWS, or you can do it via the command line, and you can give people access to do specific jobs within an environment. I have these programmed into my system right now, so that we can actually see what it's going to do. From there, we're going to create an internet gateway, because your boxes need to be able to talk to the internet. Okay? And we're going to declare a VPC, because I like all of my systems to sit inside a VPC, so that they can communicate with each other, and it adds that layer of security. Okay? I'm going to give the VPC a specific CIDR block, and I'm going to just give it some tags, just so that you can see it freely in the AWS console. I'm going to prove to you that there is nothing currently in the AWS console apart from the default VPC. If that refreshes, you'll see that there is only one VPC in place. Okay. Let's layer this demo. Console. Some files in here. There's one, which is providers, two, which is AWS VPC. And then for the purposes of the demo, I'm giving them numbers to show the order in which I'm going to layer them into the account. Okay? In real life, which I'll show you the proper example of how this code is going to look and how we use modules in order to reuse it across environments, it's going to look vastly different. And I mean vastly. So if I just say Terraform plan, it's going to take the files, the local TF files, it will form a graph of their state, okay, and it'll work out that it needs an internet gateway and a VPC, and it will give those values, and it will compare those against what the state is in AWS. Okay? And in this case, because there's nothing currently in AWS, Terraform is telling us, I am going to create create an internet gateway, and I'm going to create a VPC. So let's apply it. Terraform apply. And what that's going to do is it's going to take plan, and it will actually go off and create it. And this is interacting with AWS EC2 API. If I run a proxy on my system, you could see the calls going through, and you could actually, if you could have the right certificates, you could actually see the interactions. And we can see that the VPC has been created and the internet gateway has been created. Now, that's interesting, because what it's done is it's created the VPC first and then the internet gateway. But look, in my file, I have actually specified the internet gateway first and then the VPC. But if you notice on line 2, I'm actually referencing the VPC ID that gets created as part of the resource further down. So Terraform is building that complex graph of the interactions between our system. Excuse me. So we can actually have a look at that. Terraform has a way of being able to do that. You can graph your infrastructure. And you can actually get the output of what the graph looks like as it's building that graph. And I wrap everything in make files just because I like to think of myself as a sysadmin, when I'm not really a sysadmin. And a make file is a sysadmin way of doing things. And I can just run the command make graph. Okay, and it's going to actually run the command terraform graph and pipe it through a package on my Mac called dot. Okay, and then save the output as a PNG. And if I make, if I open graph, you can actually see that internet gateway depends on VPC, which depends on the provider. But you can, as you keep layering your infrastructure in place, you can keep graphing. And you can start to build up the picture of how your infrastructure looks. This is extremely useful, because if you have a longer running network infrastructure, what's the first thing that you usually ask when you join a company? Does anyone have a network topology diagram? And the answer is usually, yeah, but it hasn't been updated in a while. Because we don't like updating things. We don't like documentation. Code is our documentation right here. It's generating it for us. Brilliant. It means I don't have to do something. My life is easier and I get to have an extra cup of coffee. So let's actually add in something else. Now, if I actually say Terraform plan, it will compare what's on my local machine against AWS and it'll say no changes. Everything is currently looking good. It should. Goes off, freshes the state, and then it'll say, no changes. So let's pretend that we're a nasty piece of work, and somebody's gone and gone, do you know what? I just need to make a quick fix in something in our infrastructure. So they go onto the AWS console, and you can see, actually, VPC is right here, which is good. I forgot to show you that, I'm sorry about that. And what they do is they go, let's pretend that this is like CIDR block or something that, that they need to change rather than just a tag in AWS, and they can just say new tag. So, and they've, I'm trying to save the page. They've actually gone into the console and changed that, and if I refresh it, we should see that it says new tag. Now the next time I run Terraform, it's actually going to tell me that someone has gone and manually made a change that is not currently in my infrastructure. I told you at the start about configuration management tools, keeping everything at a known level. Terraform is doing exactly the same in my infrastructure. Now this is not, I'm not saying that this supersedes the need for a configuration management tool. No, not in the slightest. It can work very much in combination. This is for infrastructure. Can do package management and deployments and bits and pieces like that on it. But this specific example is no. This is actually maintaining the state of a level of infrastructure. Okay. And if I say Terraform apply again, any questions?
No question.
Anyone awake? Don't know what day it is? I actually don't. I think I've only slept for like 5 hours since I left. So, Now, the nice thing is that obviously we're, we've got a conference with a lot of people on the same Wi-Fi as I'm on, okay, but it's actually still proven that it's a decent speed. So what we can do is we can actually say Terraform destroy. Yes. It's going to destroy the infrastructure that created. We're getting into the area now, fast implementing environment. Ooh. No need for a staging environment anymore, right? Not when we could just spin up an environment really quickly and test some systems. This has multiple benefits for your company. One, cost management. You do not need to continually keep long-running infrastructure in place. You can actually spin, if you're in the cloud, that is, if you're in physical data centers, we have a different scenario and we can talk about that. We can actually talk about that a little bit, okay? But you're actually in the scenario now where you only have to keep a staging environment. You can call it X, you can call it whatever you want. It doesn't have to be the word staging. But you're in that scenario now where you can spin it up quickly, test your system, tear it back down. This is extremely useful for QAs. Any QAs in here? No. I was going to run down and give one of them a hug. But this is really good for QAs because the one problem that QAs continually have is that A, operations are blockers for their environment. Just because everyone in the company is asking operations for things. And the poor QAs are always the ones left behind. They really are. Okay. And B, they can spin their own environment. Anyway, so let's bring in something else. Number three, public subnets. So we're inside our VPC. A typical VPC topology looks like three private subnets, three public subnets. Many of them as you want, it's entirely up to you. I don't really mind. For me, I like three private and three public. I like to keep all of my instances, all of my databases, any of my infrastructure in private subnets. I only ever put like load balancers and stuff like that in the public subnets. Therefore, I'm using a 22 subnet mask. That's not really a huge amount of IP addresses. Okay. A slash 16 is 65,536 IP addresses. I believe slash 22 is somewhere in the region of 2,000. Correct. And we have three. And then from there, we're going to create a rug table because each of the subnets needs to be able to tool to go via the rug table to the internet gateway. And then we actually create the route associations to tell it the subnets are actually connected to the gateway. Really easy. So what's that going to look like? Let's make a graph. Ooh, it's got a little bit more complex. And we can straight away see that obviously the provider is the center of our universe, and the VPC is very closely behind it. But we can now start to see the interdependency that the subnet private public and the secondary public and the tertiary public and the internet gateway are all pretty much on the same level and they all depend on the VPC. But the route tables are actually required for the route associations and the route associations are created after the subnets. So you can actually see how that works. Oh, and everything at this level right here. See all this level? That can actually all be run in parallel. Terraform is very clever at being able to work out, because they are not interdependent, I am going to run them in parallel. And you can pass in parallelization equals 20 or 30, whatever you want. By default, I think it's four. Four things happening at the same time is okay. That means it works at a decent speed. And we can actually run it. Let's plan it first. And you can see plan, 9 to add, 0 to change, 0 to destroy. We have a VPC, a subnet, a route table association, a route table, and an internet gateway. And we can terraform and apply them. And that'll roll out. So that'll take a few seconds to roll out. Let's go have a look at the next part of the code. Now, we're going to need an SSH key, okay? Because we do. You're going to need at some point to have the SSH into one of the boxes. Let's pretend you have a Bastion box that you want to go in and jump around in your internal network. You can associate an SSH key with that box. Okay, sorry, Windows developers. There are ways of doing this with Windows. And hopefully, the new Windows server with OpenSSH is going to be brilliant, so then everyone's life's going to be a bit better. But for right now, we're only dealing with Linux boxes, just because my work was like Now, you'll see that it's added the 9 resources from before, and we can go in and we can see the VPC is there. Here's the VPC, and if we go into the subnets tab, you can see Agile in there, public subnet, public subnet, public subnet, and then it's in. You can change the tags, whatever you want. Anyway. Now, this code is saying, create a key pair with the name Agile India. And the content of that file that I'm going to upload will go and do a lookup on the directory of SSH/ and then agile_india.pub. Here's the SSH directory. There is nothing in it right now. It's an empty directory. Let's see what Terraform does on that. Oh, it's going to warn us straight away before it tries to change our infrastructure that something is missing. It's validating what we're trying to do. In fact, you might not be able to see it at the back. It's actually validating what we're trying to do before it uploads it to production. It's telling us that that file does not exist. Let's make it. Some sample code that does that, and it just basically runs SSH keygen of type RSA and calls it Agile India. And if we have a look of tree shell SSH, you'll see that it actually now has Agile India public and non-private key. Let's go and see what Terraform does now. Going to tell us everything else is good except for the fact that we need a public key, and I'm going to create that public key for you. And you can see it's a public key, so don't panic. You can copy it, paste it, you can do whatever you want with it. Don't worry. But it'll actually give you the exact contents of the public key that it's going to upload for you, so that you can see it and check it before you're, before you actually apply it and make sure that everything works as expected. So let's have a look at that. Apply. Let's just prove you that there currently are no keys. It might have created it just because I'm waiting on it to refresh. Okay, good. There are no keys in here apart from a call that was given last night on the same AWS account as me. And you'll see when I refresh in a second that I will create that key. A lot of traffic. I was just profiling to see the speed, and I'm getting about 1.4 megaseconds. So it's a little bit slower. You see that it adds one resource, the apply is complete. If I go and refresh the page, we'll see Agile India. Right. No problem. This is brilliant. We're building up a layer of our infrastructure. Let's go and add the next piece in. Security groups. People laugh at my accent when I say security. I have a really messed up accent between Irish and American and English. So they're like security. But security groups are very useful in the fact that you can restrict access to your pieces of infrastructure from certain locations and certain CIDR blocks. So locations being on VPN or within your network or your home computer or your office, and then other security groups can be layered to say, but inside our network, only these machines can talk to these machines. So because you don't, sometimes you don't want to like grant everybody, every application inside your infrastructure to talk to your database. Okay? Because if somebody tries to run a destructive action and they don't realize they're running a destructive action, they can cause a problem. So security groups would lock that down to only apply the specific actions. So I just have two security groups, three security groups. four security groups, sorry, that rolls out. The first one is a node. I apply a security group just for this demo that every node in my infrastructure will talk to.
Every other node.
In production, I've never done this. Never, ever, ever done this. I apply the correct security groups. Then I have a NAT box. Okay. I'm going to roll out a box that we can SSH into. And that I'm actually saying allow SSH access to that box from anywhere as long as you have the key. Okay, that's the ingress port 22, CIDR block 0000. That's anywhere. Okay. And then allow access port 80 and port 43 because the boxes that we roll out later in the private subnets need to be able to talk to 80 and port 43 to download things. Then I have a web box, which we can talk to in port 8080. And then lastly, we have an ELB, which we're going to use later on, again, on port 8080. No problem. Let's roll that up. So if I say plan, it's going to show me four security groups, and it's going to show me all the ingress and egress rules of each one. You don't have to worry about that. It builds a hash so that it remembers the numbering and the order in which they need to roll out. But we'll just let this apply, and then we'll go and we'll have a look at the next. Terraform apply. Done. I'll just let that apply in the background. So, number six, actually, let's have a look now, and we'll come back in a second. Number six, a NAT server. Pre-December 2015, okay, we had to create our own NAT instances in AWS. Okay, they didn't have a way of doing it for us. And what a NAT server is a box that every other system talks through to get access to the outside world. Okay, because sometimes you want to stop malicious traffic coming into your system and also leaving your system. So you would actually control it with a NAT server. Okay? NAT gateways are a new managed thing from AWS. We'll look at those a little bit later in a different part of the demo. Okay? But this is the root, bog standard, old way of doing the NAT boxes. If you're still doing it this way, that's fine. Okay, I'm not saying you have to go and change. This is the way some of my production infrastructure works right now. I haven't needed to migrate because it just introduces a risk that I don't need to.
And then you can see the config in a second.
It's going to roll out an instance based off an AMI. Okay, you can go and look up the specific AMIs that you want. This is using EBS-backed SSD 64-bit AMI from AWS. There is a site that you can go to that I'll show you if you really want to, that just lists all the AMIs. It's really boring, but it'll allow you to go and pick up ones if you want to. We're going to show later building our own AMIs, okay, because I think that's a key point of how you change it for infrastructure going forward. Next, we're going to say a specific instance type. AWS has instance types. We're going to go for T2 Micro because I'm really cheap and I get them free as part of my account. Okay. I don't like paying for things if I don't have. We're going to give it a subnet ID because we want to actually say, take this box and put it in a subnet. I'm going to give it the primary private subnet, so US West 2A for me. We're going to give it some security groups so that I can SSH in. We're going to give it an availability zone, again, US West 2A. We're going to give it that key name, the Agile India key name that I created the key pair. And we're going to say associate an IP address. So Terraform then has this ability to create a connection to that box. Oh, good, it's fine. So I just described this part right here. Okay, this top part. Terraform has the ability that we can create a connection to the box. And we're going to say create a connection to the box using the user Ubuntu and using the key file that's in the SSH folder. The one that we've created as part of our setup. Okay? And then when you've created that box, when you connect it to that box, run these scripts on them. So these are just really simple scripts that set up NAT. So it's IP tables, changes from IP for route masquerading, and then it just forwards all IPv4 config requests. So it's going to go and do that. And we go back and we can see that it's rolled out security groups from before. Let's have a look at what that's done to our graph. See, it's got even a little bit more complex now. You can start to see all the interactions between the systems, talking to the VPC and the provider, and you should actually be able to see a little instance right here.
Yay.
Instance is there. Brilliant. And Terraform plan again. And all it's going to do at this point, all it should do at this point, rather, is create an instance. And again, while this is rolling out, I'll come back and I'll show you the next part, which we layer in pieces of the infrastructure. See it right at the bottom, plan, what to add, zero to change, zero to change. It's going to give us that update every time. So let's apply that, let's hope that works, I'll come back and check that in a second, and then let's go and look at number seven. Number seven. Private subnets. So private subnets are slightly different. There's two things different about them. Firstly, we say map a public IP on public IP on launch equals false. These do not get public IPs. There's no need for them to get public IPs. So turn that off. And then secondly, Terraform as part of the graph allows us to introduce something called depends on. So these subnets depend on the NAT box being created. The reason they depend on the NAT box being created is that in our route table, we say that for the route 0000, so all inbound and outbound traffic, we should pass it through the ID that gets created of that instance, in that instance. Okay? So we want all that infrastructure, all those requests to go through that NAT box. So that's the only way that they're different, and that's why we separate them different between public and private. And then again, we set up the route table associations in the same way. So here we go. It's now trying to connect to the box. So it's actually brought the box up. It knows the box is up. And it's going to try a few times. So Terraform works in a retry state. And I think it'll connect on the fourth try. I don't know what actually what. I've not tried from India to Oregon. It might be a little bit slow on the network. But it's going through the first, second, third, still hasn't been able to connect. Oh, there you go, connected. Right at the bottom, you'll see connected. And now you're going to see it's going to run SSH scripts. Hopefully. It might just be running in the background, actually. So it's connected and ran the scripts as we'd expect, so that actually we have a full NAT box and a full NAT instance, and we can go back to the AWS console. I have it open. I've gone from zero instances to one instance, no problem. Great, we can see that it's running and it's just initializing, and it has the correct security groups, etc. This is brilliant. So we'll come back, we'll run the public subnets in a second, but let's also introduce three more instances. So I told you before about how Terraform can be used to do deployments if you really want to. I have written a very rudimental package of a small application. All it does is basically, on the browser, echoes the host name and the ID of the machine that it's on back to the web server. And what we're going to do is we're going to create the first one. We're going to create to it. Oh, sorry, excuse me. We're going to connect to that box. But look, we've introduced a bastion host. We're going to say connect to that box through the bastion. Because it's a box that gets created in a private subnet, so Terraform won't be able to get to it unless it tunnels through the bastion to get there. Okay. And then when you get there, install Ruby, because I like to be a bit of a sadist and it's going to take like 20 minutes to install Ruby. And then go off to Dropbox, because that's a really, I'm going to create that as my package repository. I can get to it. Download the dev. Okay? The dev is like a very small package for Ubuntu. Install the dev, install a gem, and set it, basically start the service. Start server. There's going to be three of those rolling out. Okay? And then we're going to output the IPs. We can actually output pieces of the infrastructure and the artifacts that Terraform creates back to the console for us. Terraform is going to output the IPs of those systems back to us, so that we can actually see what they are and we can use those elsewhere. And then lastly, I'm going to roll this out all at the same time. We're going to create an ELB. It's not like a load balance my applications. You never really run one application in production or one instance of an application in production. You run multiple instances of an application in production and you load balance it. So we're going to roll out an ELB, and we're going to say the instances in that ELB will be private 1, private 2, private 3. Every instance will listen on port 88, and it will have a health check to make sure that the application is responding on port 88. And then we're going to output the DNS of that ELB. Notice that I'm actually creating this in a public subnet, because we like to confuse things, instead of saying internal equals true for private and then public equals true for public, we actually have to say internal equals false. So that's a documented limitation of AWS API. And if we make the graph again, we can start to see how this is going to layer up. So this is the infrastructure that we've actually built up as part of today. But you can see that it can get complex very quickly. And we have an ELB which sits right at the top. And then we have the instances, and the root table associations, and so on and so forth. We couldn't draw this by hand. There is no way on earth we can draw this by hand. It just doesn't matter. So let the tool do it for us. All right, let's go and have a look. What it's doing right now is it's created the public subnets. We can see that they're creating. And it's finished creating the root table association after the subnets. And now it should actually start to roll out the instances themselves. Because you can see that it's instantiated. It actually says, create that instance, and that goes off and creates it in the background. And then we can see that it's trying to do 1 and 2. I don't know if you can see that right here. AWS Private 1 and AWS Private 2, it's doing those in parallel because they have no need to be run one after the other. Traditional configuration management tools do things serially, one step at a time. This will do as many as it needs to at the same time, which is great. And it'll connect to the box at some point, hopefully. Again, it might be a little bit slower. But we can actually go to the AWS console and we can actually see that there are now 4 boxes in here. You can see private instance 1, private instance 2, and private instance 3. Now, the smaller the box, unfortunately, the longer it is to initialize, just because the box doesn't have as much power in order to do its initial checks when it comes up. So it's usually a little bit slower to do these types of private instance checks. So it's still trying to connect. It will connect at some point. You'll see connected on 3, 2, and 1, and now you'll just see it installing the work. Installing all sorts of rubbish in there. So while that's happening, has anyone got any questions? So this is going to take a few minutes to install. So we'll come back and have a look at it. So the question is the retry mechanism only available through Terraform or via the AWS API? So the AWS SDKs themselves have actually got retries built into them. Use that part of the API. The Terraform has just its wrapper code written in Go around the APIs, and it's taking care of the retries and the status checks for you. So you don't, like, I didn't have to go in and say my Terraform code, retry this until Terraform knows that the state of a box should be available or running or whatever the status is, and it will continually try to pull that until that point is required. Question is, does it equally work for Azure? Yes. Tentatively. No, it does. I actually wrote the Azure provider. So if it doesn't work, you can blame me. Yes?
So in your Terraform file, I saw that you defined 3 different hosts. I think the metadata for all of them is the same, right? So why not just like say count equal to 3?
We can do that. We can. What I wanted to do right now is show you the simplistic, the most, the literally most simplistic setup that you could possibly see. For some reason, some of the boxes have failed. I'm going to go on and look at those. But what we want to do is just show you, if you're a beginner with the infrastructure, you can lay it out this way. But what we're going to do is we're going to refactor this and actually move it into what's called modules and use a constant splat syntax. So stick with me. Promise you that we'll get there. We will get there. Now, let's have a look and see why that didn't work. This is most frustrating. One of the 503 that failed to fetch. Awesome. Ruby. Amazing. Okay. So let's pretend that one worked. And we'll skip on because I'm rapidly running out of time. So again, you can. The question would usually be, okay, is, but I have just created all of that infrastructure in US West 2. What if I wanted to do it in EU West 1? I don't have to copy and paste all that code, do I? The answer is no. You refactor what's called modules. Let's close that. Actually, you know what? Let's Terraform destroy. Let's just check that it's all destroying. One, two, three, back and out. So let's start with what's called a module layer. I'll show you some sample Azure stuff. Hopefully if I get time. So modules are packages of Terraform code. And we got mostly developers in here. Think of modules as like a helper method, right? A way of just being able to manipulate some data and actually push it out in the other way. Exactly what a module is. And if you look at the setup of our VPC module, you'll see that it takes a name, CIDR block, public subnets, private subnets, and availability zones. So those are the variables that we're going to pass into our network. And then you can see interpolation is the whole way down through the system, but there is the use of count. So we no longer have to say, public subnet, public subnet, public subnet, private subnet, private subnet, private subnet. We're saying private subnet using a count of the public subnets that you pass in. So if you pass in two, it knows it's going to have to create two. If you pass in three, it knows it's going to have to create three, and so on and so forth. And then each CIDR block, we can actually say, take the index of the public and the private subnets, pass in the list of the IP addresses for the public subnets, iterate over that list, and when you get 0, 1, and 2, and those being the counts, call out the numbers at those point and set those. So the interpolation is a little bit complex, as you can see, but it means that it's all packaged away. Lastly in here, we've done things slightly different. No longer have we created a man instance. We've actually now created a new resource called AWS NAT Gateway. And NAT Gateway is the managed service that you can go and you sign up to if your account has access to it. And you can actually say, for every one of our subnets, that's this syntax right here, aws_subnet.public.star, it's called the splat syntax. Go and get all the IDs of our public subnets and allocate each one of those subnets to all of the elastic IPs that we've created above. Because you need to give a NAT gateway a public IP in the same way as I gave my NAT instance, the one before, a public IP. So you can go and create an association that way. And then at the end, output private subnets, public subnets, availability zones, and the name, the VPC ID, and the CIDR block. So we can reuse all that information that how do we do it? I declare a provider again, and I give it a region, or you can let your system use the region. I'm going to create an SSH key, which I ran the generation just before I came in here, just to show you what happened. Okay. And here's some code I prepared earlier. We declare a module. Now, right now, I'm keeping my modules here and my Terraform code here. This module path could be a gateway. It will go off and it will download from GitHub. So if you have a central registry of your modules, it will go off and download those for you. The name of the VPC is Agile India.
Yeah.
The CIDR block is 10.0.0.0/16, so you have all 65,000 IP addresses available within that CIDR block. The public subnets and the private subnets are this, and let's use the availability zones 2A, 2B, and 2C. Let's just make sure that it's... That will do. There is currently no VPCs at the minute, apart from our default VPC, because we've torn everything down again. Everything's gone. Great. Terraform plan. It's actually going to tell us, because right now if we look at the code, let's say you're a developer, and I'm an infrastructure engineer. Actually, that is the way, right? But the way it works is that sometimes you as a developer, you don't care what the implementation of what's inside the VPC is. You don't care. All you want to do as a developer is spin up a system that has a VPC, and you want to give it these systems. So I would give you a module path, and then when you run Terraform CLI, it will actually show you everything it's going to do. And it's quite a complex layout. You know, it's going to add 28 things. But as a developer, you've just had to declare 8 lines of code. 8 lines of code worth of space. It's pretty easy. So let's roll this up. Let's make graphics first. And then Terraform apply. In its first instance, become complex from the layout. You know, as a developer, if you're given that small package of code, it's nice to actually try, if you're interested, to understand what it is. The graph command works really well. So it's going off and it's doing its thing, and it will finish pretty shortly.
Yeah.
And it will give us everything we want, but if we look at the VPC right now, we'll actually see that it's there.
Forward night.
Yep. We should have 6 subnets at this point. Public 1, public, well, name. So public 3, 2, and 1, private 3, 2, and 1. They're all there, they're all associated, they have the correct CIDR blocks, and you can see that it has the correct IP ranges, 2043 available, and 1018 available, because you keep some in reserve. There it is. And right at the bottom, it'll actually finish, and it will allow us to do it. So before we created a bastard box to get into this, I'm not a fan of a NAT gateway or a bastard box where you put SSH in and then SSH in a run. I'm not a massive fan of those. They feel to me like a single point of failure, that if it goes down, you then have to roll out a new one and you have to move it around. So what I'm actually going to do is I'm going to actually roll out an open VPN so that we can connect to the boxes. We can actually connect to our VPN and then talk to any boxes inside without having to tunnel in through a specific box in SSH. So we've written some module code for this. It's not, it's actually available out there. OpenVPN, you can go and have a look at it. So it has a CIDR block, it has a security group that allows ingress and egress rules on different ports, different protocols. It has an instance and it gives you an IP that comes back. And again, I have written some code that does this already. So we're going to declare the AMI that we want. Open VPN have already created AMIs that are available in the AWS workplace, so in the marketplace, excuse me. And we can go and grab one of the specific AMI for the specific region that we're in.
Okay.
We're going to again give the source of the module. We're going to give it the VPC ID. But look, we're actually saying get the VPC ID from module VPC, and then get the VPC ID. So we're actually using the state that comes back from one module to reuse in another. We give it the public subnets, we give it that AMI, we're actually passing this AMI into it, and we pass the key name in, and then we're going to get a VPN IP and a settlement, a compiler. And you can see that it's actually created the first one. Let's make a graph again, just I like to see how it's going. And then Terraform apply, and it's going to roll out. So the graph is again, it's got a little bit more complex, and it has actually added in some VPN. It would be really helpful if I saved the file, right? It would be really helpful. Apologies about that. So this is just going to come back and say that there are no changes required. There you go. Make graph. Terraform apply. And it's going to roll that out. And look, you can see that it's, again, graph changed instantly. It's become a little bit more complex, where we have actually got our OpenVPN, our security groups, which talk to a provider and an SSH. Which then talk to our actual AWS provider. And it's going to go and create that. Question? Inside that security group, you give it the rules, okay? But then you actually have an external rule, which is a security group rule, which has to add to Terraform. Then you get into the cycle of Terraform thinking that it has to apply the changes, remove that external rule, and then reapply it. So it's in there a little bit of a cycle. That is something that's actively being worked on. So, but yes, it is idempotent, and you can see that if I ran it, and it doesn't need to do any changes, it doesn't need to make any changes to my infrastructure, which is good. It's a very good
thing. I have just one point to
of course.
Instances. Now it is, when you apply it, then it will get create those instances over the cloud. Then making the part of specific domain, making sure that the other configurations to be done on the system, will it happen with the same module or does it need to be done some different tool?
Yeah. Well, let me see if I can understand the question. The question is, once the instances are up and they're part of our domain, or they're part of our system and they're actually into, you know, so like say you've brought up instances that you're actually going to run tests on, you're asking, would Terraform roll this the code out as well?
No. So that would be other systems like for the CI/CD part of it, which will come into the picture, but here about joining the part of the domain and other. So as of now, it is doing all the configurations related to the security, network addresses.
Gotcha. So the question is that if we're in something like a Windows environment, when the boxes come up, would Terraform take care of making them part of the domain?
Yeah.
The answer is yes, I believe so. You would have to write some extra code in the Terraform config for it, but yes, it can do that. It's just because we're not using Windows boxes right now, it's very simplistic because the Linux boxes just come up and you either SSH in or you don't, right?
Yeah.
But yes, I know exactly what you mean, and you can do that. So there are methods in Terraform that will allow you to manipulate vSphere, for example, and because you can then run external scripts in vSphere, it can actually join the domain.
Thank you.
Okay, so we've added our VPN. Now we're going to actually go and see if we can connect to our VPN. So SSH-I, because we're going to pass the identity file that we want. Agile India. Oh, excuse me, it's the test key, it's not Agile India. And we're going to, the user is openvpn.as at the IP address that I created. And I should now be able to SSH in. Verifies the identity. And we're going to go configure our VPN. So there we go. So You're in OpenVPN, as I say. They have created this box, so all the configuration has all been redone for you, which is excellent. And you have a license that can't be agreed to. You can read that. Who reads the licenses?
No one.
Should read licenses.
Very important.
And then it'll ask you some initial questions.
Okay.
I have the answers here. You can go and read about the answers. I don't really want to go through each one all the time. Creates a user called OpenVPN. I'm just going to change the password for simplicity's sake.
Sudo password OpenVPN.
Let's just change the password to password. Don't ever do this in production,
please.
And what we're going to do is we're going to connect to that box in our browser. We have no limits here, so I'm just going to trust that we will roll out a certificate. This is like a very rudimental demo. Let's go to it. And it will actually give us an OpenVPN client for Connect. So we're going to log in. OpenVPN password. And we now, if you download the profile, we now have a profile in which we can SSH. So I use a small SSH tool or a small VPN client called Viscosity on Mac. As you can see at the top, I've just clicked it, it's opened it in Viscosity, so I can connect to that client. So let's come out of this box. And if I connect to the client, I'm actually inside our VPC at this point. Really good. Open VPN. Password. And just see it's connected. Brought up some private instances before, and we deployed an application to it. Okay. But our way of deploying the application is going off the Dropbox, downloading a file, and doing a dpkg install of that dev file. Nasty. What we're going to do is we're going to build an AMI of our application. I am going to use something that has a UI called console. Okay, it's one of the HashiCorp bugs, just because we have been doing this for this time for a while. We have pre-built AMIs and pre-built scripts that do this for us. So we use a tool called Packer.
Okay.
Packer is a way that you can declare how an AMI looks, not just an AMI, but also a Vagrant box or a Docker file or any of these systems, but how it's configured,
okay,
where it's built, and then lastly, after it's built, you can export that to different places. So like, for example, Packer can take an image, build it in US West 2. When it's finished with the AMI, you can copy the AMI across to EU West 1, US East 1, and so on and so forth. So for one build, you can copy that exact same artifact, which comes back to the keynote first thing this morning about everything being an artifact, across to different locations. Excuse me? Yes, the question is it possible Azure or is it possible? Yes, you can build Azure disks with this as well. It's an awesome tool. It's really useful. Really useful. If you Google Packer Windows, then you'll actually see a huge amount of configuration already around Windows Server, and you'll be able to use a lot of the open source templates for Azure. And inside this build, all it's going to do is it's going to, this uses Amazon Linux, it's just going to install the EC2 tools. It's going to go off to a pre-configured box, and it's going to install console. I actually created this morning because it takes about 5 minutes or 6 minutes to build an AMI, depending on how complex it is, where it's copying it to. So I have an AMI ID already. Okay. And I'm going to take this AMI, which ends in EB4. Again, I have code that's already written for this. It's going to declare that console API, AMI, which it ends in EB4. Okay. It's going to gonna go off, install console. As a, you know, it's gonna use the console module, which spins up three boxes, load balances the three boxes, gives them an elastic, excuse me, an ELB, gives us that DNS and the ELB back, and then it actually will configure those instances. Okay, let me rephrase it. What it'll do is it'll go off and spin up the instances, but the instances are based already off a console AMI. So therefore, all the work for configuring the instance has already been done. And because it's already been done, the time to start the application is just the time for the box to boot, which is much faster. This is a lot of the way that Netflix used to do their deployments in the cloud, Spinnaker, and those types of systems, where they pre-bake their AMIs with their applications and then just launch the application, just launch the AMIs, and that way they could actually use them. It's got a launch config and it's got an autoscaling group, so that we'll actually be able to show that it's self-healing. So let's Terraform apply, make sure that it starts to work. Excellent. So I'm going to show you the graph now. It's got a lot more complex. Not really even fit it on the screen. And it'll get even more complex as we start to add more pieces to the system in place. Done it again. It's actually clear. Now as part of this, we want AMIs to have roles and policies because we don't want everything to be an administrator inside our system. So the console module, which is open source for Terraform, has actually got the correct policies inside it. Now, when I say policies, I mean this. Console policies. We want the server to be able to get, be able to describe the autoscaling groups, describe the instances in that group, describe the availability zones, instance attributes, instance status, and tags, and so on. Because there are scripts built into this console AMI that require us to look up the other servers in the cluster so that it can form a cluster. Okay, or excuse me, the other servers in AWS to form a console cluster. So it does a lookup on the autoscale group, grabs the instances, and then for each instance it goes off and gets the IP so that it can actually form the correct config. But if we go to AWS, we should now see that we have got more instances. Excellent. Here's our console instance, it's all starting right now. Instance, state, run. So we have one console server, it hasn't finished creating the other two right now, so they'll find the instances, but if we refresh again, see the third one. And for some reason it's locked, it's not letting me see that. Well, we can actually see that it's Agile India console server, Agile India console server, Agile India console server. We see the IPs, and then at the end, we actually get an ELB address. So everything has happened right now inside the private subnet. Let's try and connect to that ELB, or that, excuse me, that instance. And it's port 8500, and it doesn't resolve. Because it's an internal action, and what I would usually have had to do before I had a VPN client is I would have had to tunnel through into my bastard box and then curl to make sure that I could get it. Let's just connect to our VPN. This is why VPN solutions are a little bit better. I nearly typed it. Thinking about it. in the background, and it's actually formed a cluster at this point. It's a little bit slow just because I'm VPN'd in the Oregon, so you'll have to forgive the slowness of this. But at this point, we can actually see that we've just built a 3-node cluster, which is great. So what I'm going to do is, I've said that this is backed by an autoscaling group. An autoscaling group is a way in AWS of you saying that I need this group of servers that have a specific role to a specific number of servers. We've told console we need 3. Let's go into AWS, and let's actually delete one of the instances. This, the equivalent action in Azure is an availability set. Because you would actually give it a specific number of machines in that availability set, and it would then bring the box back up to match it. So let's terminate one of the boxes. I'm gonna go back to console and refresh. I'm really hopeful that it'll actually refresh at this point. Just take a second, because the box hasn't finished shutting down yet. And look, one of the boxes has actually gone unresponsive. The agent is not live or it's unreachable. And we'll come back to that in a second and it will actually spin some time. So console is a very specific application that does a specific job. Anyone use Elasticsearch? Let's spin up an Elasticsearch cluster, right? Because that's a little bit more visible, it has a little bit more of a configuration to it rather than just anything else. So what we can do is we can go back to our Packer scripts and build an Elasticsearch cluster. So the template.json actually said build an Elasticsearch image, give it the specific time that you want it to be, you know, give it the name of the image, the AMI name, an instance type that you want it to be based on. Now, we have 3 types of provisioners at this point. Packer is made of it's made of builders and provisioners. Okay, and then it's got a third one, which is package operators. We don't need to package because we're building on AWS and we can actually take care of using the AMI off the end. But first one is we install some dependencies. So that's like Git, Ansible, because we're going to use Ansible to show that you can actually use Packer and a configuration management tool together. Okay. We're actually going to install Python DevTools. We're going to install pip. And we're going to install pip install Ansible, Jinja 2, Netface, Photo, AWS API, CLI, etc., etc. When it's finished, run the Ansible playbook called Elasticsearch, which just installs a role of Elasticsearch. And the role of Elasticsearch looks like this. Install Java, accept the Java 8 license. This is a really good hack around actually having the install Java. It's a little bit slower, but it's fine. Add the Elasticsearch repo, install the Elasticsearch package itself, copy some configurations and Jinja configuration around, install some plugins, so you can actually give it a list of plugins to install. And then lastly, and the most important thing, is when the box boots, set Elasticsearch to be enabled and it's only running. You can go and you can create that Packer or that AMI. I've already done that because it takes a little bit longer because it's using it's using Ansible, so not only does it have to install dependencies, it has to install Ansible. So we have a pre-baked AMI that does this, it's right here. And if I go back to, let's close all. Yes, US West 2, name. If I go back, I can grab the Elasticsearch configuration I wrote. And it's declared in the same way. Declare an AMI ID, run the module, use that module, pass in specific credentials that you need, give it an instance type, give it an N3R because we want our Elasticsearch instances to be quite chunky, and then at the end, I'll put an ELB address. Now, if we were quite clever, I haven't ran anything just yet. It has just replaced that console loop. I don't know if you saw, actually, see in a second on console AMI. So console currently has a cluster of 3 nodes. One of them is down. If I refresh, very shortly I should get a 4th. Hopefully. Yep, there's a 4th node. Okay, so it has actually used autoscaling to bring the cluster back to a healthy state. really useful. Look up autoscale inputs if you're in AWS and you don't currently use them. It will save you a lot of time, guaranteed. So lastly, let's just make sure I've saved the file. So that's one. Let's have a look at the graph. The graph has got even more complex. You can start to see the topology of your whole system, how your systems interact with each other because of security groups, and so on. It's going to take a few minutes for the Elasticsearch stuff to roll out. So let's go back and answer a question that I asked before. Why would we use a module? We didn't want to have to copy and paste the code when we went from US West 2 to EU West 1. All we actually have to do is actually reuse a sample. So if I create a new folder here called EU West 1, and in here if I create SSH, I am going to copy the make file across, just because I'm lazy. And I'm going to create a test key again. And then inside main, if I just take those two, right, or those three declarations, exactly the same module, just changing five lines of code in order to roll out the same system. I worked at a startup until very recently, and at that startup it actually took me 6 minutes to deploy our entire infrastructure to a new AWS region. The reason it was 6 minutes is because it took 6 minutes for the Amazon RDS instance to come up, because it's a database and it's a little bit faster or a little bit slower and it has to go through all its checks. That was our disaster recovery. That was our 6 minute downtime. So it's building the Elasticsearch instances, which is great. If I refresh, I should see three new instances. Elasticsearch, they're on their way. You can see the first one's in. Terraform is a gem I already have installed. And you can actually say terraforming, this is to go and get the existing state. If you don't manage your infrastructure right now in AWS with Terraform, and you just manage it manually, you can import it using terraforming and it will actually build it for you. And if I say terraforming EC2, it's going to go off and get me all the instances that I currently have in my account. I actually need to pass in a region. It's just a little bit slow right now. But you can actually see all the instances that are there written as Terraform config and taking advantage of it. Thanks for that. Elasticsearch cluster should be running right now. And we can go to Elasticsearch. It might be a little bit slower because it's a Java. Most important part of that is that S3 nodes. Really easy to just launch an Elasticsearch cluster in like 50 seconds, maybe even a minute. Brilliant, so quick to do. And again, we could go into the AWS console, we could destroy one, and Amazon would replace it because of the autoscaling group. And because of the Ansible code that we wrote, I can actually say plugin Marvel, which is one one of the plugins. I've actually installed a ton of plugins as part of it, just so that you can see that it actually goes off and installs some plugins. And this is the Marble plugin, which gives you an insight into your Elasticsearch cluster, which is brilliant, absolutely amazing. I have 7 minutes. It's a little bit slow. So, what else can we do with it? We've done AWS. We're not going to have time to probably show some demos of Azure, it's a little bit slower, but the code looks in exactly the same way. You declare a provider, okay? You have some authentication that you need to do with Azure to get some credentials back. You declare a resource group, because the new way of doing things with the new Azure resource manager is everything gets grouped inside a resource group. We can create a virtual network. We can create subnets in the same way as we did before. And if you go and have a look at the docs to the providers, Azure RM, the things you can manage, the CDNs, DNS, network resources, search resources, SQL resources, storage resources. And just last night, we actually merged virtual machines. So virtual machines is going to be in Terraform 0.6.14, which is really good, which means it's a complete set of being able to manage your Azure infrastructure. Some of the other providers I actually use are DigitalOcean. I love DigitalOcean because it's a really simple cloud provider that I can spin box stuff very fast, really quick. It's like super quick as well. And they say that you can spin up a DigitalOcean droplet in 50 seconds. So let's put that to the test. And the only thing that you need for DigitalOcean is you just need a DigitalOcean authentication token. And I'm going to go to DigitalOcean. Log in. There shouldn't be any droplets here right now. Excellent, there's no droplets. By the way, just to show you that Marble works, it's there, and you can actually see the Marble's in place, and it's configured. Let's go back to droplets. Terraform plan. And make SSH key. This is a lot faster, just because it's the droplets have got a much smaller footprint. Oh, excuse me. So that'll just run in the background for the next 30 seconds or so. You should actually be able to see that the droplet has been created and it's almost finished. Provision was prepared. So where do we go with it? What is this use case? So I have 4 minutes. I promise I won't keep you. I won't keep you long. In development circles, we're usually asked a question. Okay, the question was designed by Mary Poppendick, which is fantastic. How long would it take your organization to deploy a line of code, deploy a change that involves a line of code, and can you do it on a reliable, repeatable basis? And developers constantly think about that, and that's why we go back to the previous keynote by Tim Fitz, where he said about deployment pipelines and about automating all your systems. Brilliant. Because we can take advantage of these tools like Terraform, CloudFormation, SparkFormation, etc., we can ask ourselves as infrastructure the same questions. Because there's no reason why we shouldn't. What we've actually built right now is disposable environments. Not only have we built disposable infrastructure itself, the nodes and the ALBs, etc., we've built an entire disposable environment. Your QA teams will love you if you can help them implement this type of change to your company. They will absolutely love you, I promise you that. What about disaster recovery? Hands up who works in a company that requires big documents for disaster recovery? Doesn't that code look like your disaster recovery? Yeah. We've practiced. What we've actually done, in fact, anyone ever heard of the Netflix Simian Army? Anyone ever heard of Chaos Monkey? It's probably a name that's been banded around. what it does is it simulates what happens in an environment when a node goes down. What did we go and do? We destroyed one of our console nodes, and what did AWS do? It brought it back up. We've actually practiced being our own chaos monkey. There's another tool as part of the group called Chaos Gorilla. And what Chaos Gorilla does is it will simulate that an entire availability zone will go down. So that all instances in an availability zone in the subnet will go down and make sure that the system actually acts as normal. And then you've got Chaos Calm, which is what we looked at a little bit rudimentary, is by what would happen if an entire region went down. What would happen if the entire of the EU West 1 data center for AWS disappeared? And what we can do is we can just go, we can roll out those small config changes, spin up our entire cluster in US West 2, point our DNS at it, done. So this is really useful. This is stuff that's going to help you. I'm not saying that you must go back and start using infrastructure in this way. There are many ways to manage your infrastructure. This has been very successful for me for quite a while. I've been able to manage hundreds and thousands, I'm not at that scale, but I've been able to manage hundreds and thousands of boxes in this manner very simply. When you can declare such simple things as autoscale groups that are baked off AMIs at the top, life is a lot simpler. Any last questions? 30 seconds. I thank you all very much for your time. If you have any questions at all, please tweet me. I'm awful at email. You can try and email me, but you then may have to tweet me to tell me that you've emailed me. But please do get in contact, and I'm happy to share. All this code will be made available so everyone can see it, and you can go and you can try and let me know how it goes. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, Paul, for the talk.